Hello and welcome to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Delighted to be here on a Friday. We always try to have, I don't want to say we save the best for the last, but we try to have very good guests for you on Friday, and we did it this Friday. Our good friend Rylene Simpson will be here with us the second hour, and we're going to talk about accompanying those with same-sex attraction. If you know Rylene, she is the perfect person to have that conversation with. This hour, how about we talk a little bit about papal infallibility? This seems to be a sticking point for both Catholics and non-Catholics as far as the various doctrines of the Catholic faith. And who better to do that with than Michael Lofton, who's an associate apologist here with Catholic Answers and the proprietor of his own podcast, Reason and Theology. Hi, Michael.
Hey, Cy, it's great to see you, by the way.
Oh, thank you. Did I say Reason and Theology right? I panicked
you
right
did,
there because I always say it wrong, and then I started to panic.
No, you got it.
Okay. All right. Very, very good. What's been going on at Reason and Theology lately? What kind of stuff are you covering?
Oh, same old, same old. Dealing with all kinds of issues, dealing with Orthodoxy, Protestantism, and radical traditionalism. So.
All the fun stuff. Very good.
Yeah, right.
So the Pope is infallible. Mm-hmm. We don't know what, I mean most of the people on earth, we either don't know what that means or we just disapprove of the very idea that he could be infallible.
Yeah, I'm glad you raised this point because it's often misunderstood. So when we speak of papal infallibility, we're not saying that he is always right in what he says. I mean, that's most certainly not the case. So he isn't necessarily right in his judgment on whether vanilla ice cream is better than chocolate ice cream, and he's not necessarily right on whether the Knicks are going to win versus the Lakers or somebody else.
They're
like
not.
That. No. Okay. Yeah, so he's not infallible in that sense. But what we do mean is in matters of faith and morals in particular settings, on particular occasions, that what he teaches would be free from error. Not that it's expressed in the best perfect way. Yeah, and that's another thing. I mean, papal infallibility doesn't necessarily mean that the Pope expresses it in the best possible way. There could be room to grow there. However, what he does express in certain contexts would be just simply free from error. And again, it's limited to faith and morals and only in particular settings. So he could speak on a matter of faith and morals in some cases and not be infallible if he's not using that charism of infallibility.
Give me an idea of how he might do that. So the Pope's says something about the faith, and mm-hmm. I don't have to take that to be infallible. When would that happen?
A very common example is a papal encyclical. The vast majority of things that a pope discusses and proposes as far as faith and morals in, say, an encyclical would not be considered definitive, so papal infallibility would not ordinarily be employed there, although he could employ papal infallibility in such a setting as an encyclical. He just generally hasn't done so yet.
Okay.
Now, that being said, that doesn't mean that everything in an encyclical is just up for grabs. It might be authoritative, it might be binding, but whether or not the charism of infallibility is operative, in the vast majority of instances where the Pope is teaching as Pope, it might be authoritative, yet it's not necessarily infallible. It might not necessarily be free from error. Now, this would also include cases where he's not actually teaching as Pope, but he's also just kind of speaking as a private theologian, or he's speaking off the cuff. Those instances, clearly, he's not exercising the charism of papal infallibility.
That's interesting what you say about the encyclical, though. So I can't just go, look, the Pope rarely speaks infallibly. There are very specific conditions in which he does it. He put out an encyclical on, the topic is the latest encyclical. And so, take it with a grain of salt. I don't necessarily have to do what he says in there. Well, so not being infallible doesn't mean not being authoritative.
Exactly. That's an important distinction because some people will say, well, it's not infallible, therefore I can dissent from it. No, not so fast. There's a difference between infallible versus authoritative. The Pope is able to teach what we call non-definitively, non-infallibly. He's able to teach non-infallibly, yet still authoritatively, insofar as your conscience is bound to assent to what he is teaching. However, he has not taught it in such a way that it could never be reversed by the church and the teaching authority of the church.
Okay. Okay.
So it's an important distinction to make there, and people often, you know, fall off on one side of that spectrum and tend to think, oh, well, you know, if it's not infallible, I guess it's up for grabs. Nah, that's not the case.
Oh, okay. So, give me an example then of an infallible teaching, something that cannot be reversed. Like that would mean that there are some things that popes have said that even a thousand years from now, a pope comes along, Pope Michael Lofton. He's just looking back into history, taking a great saint's name, and he says, Pope Michael Lofton says he can't change what? What are the limits? Like, give me something that he can't change.
Pope Agathos teaching at the Sixth Ecumenical Council in the first millennium, so this is in the 7th century, so 680, 681, his teaching that that Jesus has two wills, yet they're not contrary to each other, but a human will and a divine will, that is infallible. So the church could never reform that and say, well, Jesus actually only has one will. You know, that would be impossible to do. Another example is a recent teaching, I think it was in 1950, Munificentissimus Deus in an apostolic constitution, Pius XII defines the proposition that the Blessed Virgin Mary ascended into heaven at the end of her earthly course. And so that would also be something that is definitively taught that we could not reverse. And there's many other instances. I mean, papal infallibility itself has been defined by an ecumenical council as something definitive. That's been infallibly taught. So we can't say that the Pope isn't infallible in those particular settings. He certainly is.
888-318-7884, whether you're Catholic or not, if you've got questions or maybe challenges that you'd like to pose for Michael Lofton about papal infallibility, you are very welcome here. 888-318-7884, 888-31-TRUTH. So primarily you're saying that it was interesting to me that you said, look, even when the Pope teaches infallibly, there's no guarantee that he's saying it in the best possible way. So there might have been a better way to say that. So the only thing we're getting then with the it seems like kind of a low bar, actually. Like, what you're getting is there's nothing in that statement that if you follow it is an error. But it could have been said better. It could be explained better. It could be put into a better context. But all we're saying is guaranteed that's the truth, and you can't deny it.
Right. It means effectively the proposition itself that is defined is free from error. But it does not mean that the proposition is expressed in the best possible way. That would be nearly impossible to do, because some of these things that are taught infallibly touch on mysteries of God, for example, the Trinity. How could we ever speak of the uncreated one in his Trinitarian aspects? How could we ever speak of these things in words in a way that really fully encapsulates it? Now, what we say about the Trinity is true. It's free from error. So the proposition is true, but is it necessarily expressed in all occasions in the best possible way? No. And so there can be some growth there, but the proposition itself can never be reversed. So we can't have growth to the point that we've completely reversed the meaning of what was proposed infallibly.
Now, I found it interesting that you went to the 7th century for your first example, because I think there are a pretty good number of people who might say, you know, this infallibility thing, it's kind of a Vatican I thing. It wasn't really a church thing before that. In the First Vatican Council, the 1860s in Rome, which occupied a good deal of its attention with issues of authority, papal authority. Before that, you know, this whole idea of papal infallibility, it just wasn't very clear.
Oh, well, that's certainly not the case, although there's a lot of people who do have that impression, okay. But that's just not factually true. I mean, Pope Agatho, and by the way, he wasn't the first pope to exercise papal infallibility in the first millennium. I mean, Pope Leo is another example with his tome. So Pope Agatho, for example, believed that Pope Martin, his predecessor, had already definitively taught the issue of Jesus having two wills at the Lateran Council in 649. And so the point is, Rome already thought that it had used this charism of infallibility itself back in the 7th century. Agatho confirms that. The Ecumenical Council Fathers confirmed that as well. And so nobody was under the impression that this was just something that, you know, did not exist. People believed that there was an indefectibility to the teaching office of the Roman papacy. Now, we can speak of some development, some tweaking to that, some better articulation in when this happens with the Roman pontiff. That certainly is a development in the second millennium. But just the idea that he can teach infallibly, bare minimum, that's something there from day one.
Okay. Again, the number is 888-318-7884. We have to take our first break. We're discussing papal infallibility with Michael Lofton from the Reason and Theology podcast. If you've got questions or challenges about the Catholic understanding of papal infallibility, you're very welcome to call 888-318-7884.
Catch Catholic Answers Live anytime at Catholic.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite monks of Wyoming. Delicious Mystic Monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All Mystic Monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase Mystic Monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
Beyond Damascus with Dan Demite and Aaron Richards is our show for young adults.
Everybody's talking about encounter. Everybody's talking about that mountaintop experience. What we fail to often talk about is what happens after. What happens beyond that Damascus moment?
Jesus Christ is calling all of us to be missionary disciples, disciples of Jesus who are on mission to bring the kingdom of God here and now on this earth.
Beyond Damascus with Dan Demite and Aaron Richards, Saturday at 8 Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Two great specials in 1 week. A couple of days ago, we brought you our $10 book sale. This weekend, all our digital products are deeply discounted, and that'll work its way till the end of July coming up here. So if you'd like deeply discounted ebooks, e-magazines, digital videos, MP3s, all that stuff, all the electronic stuff, it's $2, $4, or $6 right now. Hundreds of great resources to choose from. That sale price just goes till the end of July. Head over to shop.catholic.com and get your deals today. We're talking about papal infallibility with Michael Lofton. The number to call if you'd like to get in on that conversation, 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. So a pope how does the pope make clear to us? I guess this is the last thing I'll ask, and then I'll let callers ask questions. But how does the pope make clear to us that he has, in fact, taught infallibly?
Yeah, so he's going to articulate in whatever setting he does. So it's usually in an apostolic constitution, at least recently it is, but it doesn't have to be limited to it. But he's going to make it known in some kind of way. It will be manifest according to canon law that he's speaking about faith and morals, that he's speaking as the universal shepherd. He's not just speaking as a local bishop for the territory of Rome. He's speaking as the universal shepherd of the entire church, and he's speaking in a way that is binding in the sense of being definitively binding. So he's going to make it known in one way or another. There's no particular formula, but he's going to make it manifestly known that he is binding the entire faithful to definitively assent to what he is expressly teaching. again, that could be done in different ways. There's no particular formula.
Okay.
And at the First Vatican Council, when some fathers at the First Vatican Council suggested that there would be a particular formula, the Vatican fathers resisted it because if we gave a particular formula that's required, it would not apply to the vast majority of cases in the first millennium because there just wasn't a formula. It was simply something that was made manifest in one way or another. It was made known that he is definitively binding the entire faithful as a pope on a matter of faith and morals.
Again, 888-318-7884, the number. Have these ever come out of the blue, or are they always things you kind of knew that that was an issue that was, that the pope was either going to resolve just make permanently stable in the church? Has it ever come out of just out of the blue?
I can't think of any instance where it's ever come out of the blue. Usually it's in response to some kind of heresy going on. However, not in all cases, such as the case of the Immaculate Conception and the case of the Assumption. That was not promulgated in the context of resisting a heresy. Rather, it was promulgated because it was something that all of the faithful already assented to, and the Pope was just giving an expression to that. But usually it's because there's some kind of stir, there's some kind of problem going on from a heretic. So, for example, you have Arius who stirs up this, you know, problem in the fourth century, and so the Council of Nicaea responds to it. And so, in the same way, the Pope, when he uses his charism, it's usually in response to some kind of heresy that's going on.
All right, off to the phones we go. We're talking about papal infallibility. Your call's welcome. 888-31-TRUTH. Steve in Napomo, California, watching on YouTube. You are up first today, Steve. Go ahead with your question for our guest, Michael Lofton.
Thank you, guys. Just quickly, I'm looking at the Catholic Church side as a non-Catholic yet, but really close to jumping in the river and swimming over. What's the situation on infallibility as far as the Pope? Recent teachings, like on the Novus Ordo and getting rid of the traditional Latin Mass and other issues like that, and I don't understand praying with the people in a non-Catholic rite up in Canada with the native people. I thought you were only supposed to do Catholic rites only.
Okay. So, in other words, you're thinking of coming into the Catholic Church, but how binding are some of these things that Pope Francis is doing that don't look quite right to you? Is that it?
Yes, sir. I love Pope Paul II, love Francis. Having a tough time with the current Pope.
Having a tough time with the current Pope. Okay. So, what can Steve do with that, Michael?
Yeah, so I'm hearing two questions in there. One relates to the document from the Holy Father, Traditionis Custodis, restricting in some instances the use of the traditional Latin Mass, the extraordinary form. And then another question that I heard in there was in relation to when can we and when can we not pray with non-Catholics. So as far as the first one with this document, Traditionis Custodis, papal infallibility does not mean that the Pope is always the most prudent in the way he implements disciplinary measures, and Traditionis Custodis pertains to discipline rather than doctrine on faith and morals. So he's not using the charism of papal infallibility in Traditionis Custodis. He is instead implementing certain liturgical and disciplinary restrictions and decrees. However, I will say in those cases, even though we could perhaps question the timeliness and the prudence of some of these disciplinary measures, which the church itself allows us to do. Though we can do that, we will still say that there's an infallible safety to the universal disciplinary decisions of the church. So this is a little tricky. When it comes to discipline, we're not saying, again, that it's the most prudent, that it can't be reformed or reversed. It's not infallible in that sense. But there is a general safety. So we can speak of an infallibility from the Holy Spirit allowing the Pope to impose a discipline that would harm souls. And what we mean by harm souls here is that he would allow for some kind of universal discipline that would take people away from the path of heaven. And if they were to obey and assent to it, they would end up going to hell. The Holy Spirit would never allow such things, even in the disciplinary measures of the Holy Father. So we can say that something like Traditionis Custodis, it's not going to be harmful to souls. However, we could question the timeliness of it. Is it really also the most prudent way to deal with certain problems in the church that exist in the in some quarters of the extraordinary form? We could offer some pushback there, according to a document released by the Vatican called Donum Veritatis. So that deals with that one, although I'm happy to hear if you have any follow-ups. But as far as the second part, prayer with non-Catholics. So this is a curious one because in various parts throughout history, there has been a discipline that we generally would not pray with non-Catholics, especially those who have formally left the Catholic Church. Formal schismatics is what we would refer to. In the case of somebody who was not born a Catholic, so they didn't actually leave the Catholic Church, there have been instances historically where the Catholic Church has said it's okay to pray with them, and not only pray, but in some cases actually share in the sacraments together. So there have been instances, for example, in history where we've shared the sacraments with the Orthodox, for example. But in those cases, it would be with an Orthodox who did not leave the Catholic Church to go to Orthodoxy, but somebody who was born into Orthodoxy. However, the general disposition, even in the preconciliar era prior to the Second Vatican Council, the general disposition was to be hesitant to do that, to pray formally or even share in the sacraments with a non-Catholic. At the time of the Second Vatican Council, and especially after the council, we've somewhat changed that discipline. And what we're saying is, in some cases, it might be helpful for us to pray with non-Catholics. And so you see this in a document released by the Second Vatican Council and some of the documents after Vatican II. They talk about some of these instances where in limited cases, we can share in the sacraments together, and in limited cases, we can also pray with non-Catholics. A huge restriction, though, is if it's going to cause scandal, it's probably a good idea to not do it.
Steve, you want to follow up with that, or was that satisfying to you?
Gentlemen, thank you. You nailed it. Bless you. God bless you guys for that. That's what I don't want to misunderstand, and you guys cleared it up. So thank you very much.
Well, you're very welcome, Steve. Thank you. I thought I nailed it on that one. I definitely thought I don't know how. Yeah, Michael did okay.
I did all right, but you got it.
Thanks, Steve. Let's go to Rick in Bay City, Michigan. Is that where the Bay City Rollers come from? Do you know? All right. Listening on the Catholic Answers Live app. Rick, thanks for downloading the app onto your phone. Go ahead with your question for Michael Lofton.
I think the name Bay City Rollers came from Bay City, but I don't think they came from Bay City.
Oh, okay.
The question I have is about private revelations, and we hear that private revelations have been approved by the church, and it's hard for me to formulate the question, but I'll put it this way. Do private revelations sort of ride on the coattails of papal infallibility, or what level of authority? We never hear who provided that authority. Was it, whether it was a bishop or a cardinal or pope or what? But do they ride on the coattails of papal infallibility?
This is an excellent question because it can get complicated pretty quickly. Generally speaking, something like private revelation that the Pope has approved is not necessarily an object of infallibility. So it's not necessarily something that the Pope could propose as infallible. What could fall within his purview of infallibility in relation to private revelation would be if somehow this private revelation was necessary to maintain in order to maintain something in public revelation, that is sacred scripture or sacred tradition. If there's some kind of intrinsic connection between the two, logically or historically, then he could decree it infallibly, but I can't think of any instances where this has ever happened. So in other words, in the vast majority of cases, I don't think he could. In some incredibly rare cases, he might be able to. That being said, if a pope were to universally approve of a private revelation, I will say that it has a guarantee of safety. So it's not going to be a message that is harmful to souls. So there will be a general guidance of the Holy Spirit there. But it doesn't necessarily mean that everything in there is free from error. Now, you might be confused here because you're going to say, wait, how could something be erroneous but not harmful to souls? It's possible for a proposition to not be true and yet not be destructive to souls. If I were to say 2 + 2 = 5, That's not necessarily destructive to souls, although it could be in some cases, I would imagine. But just generally speaking, 2 plus 2 equals 5. It's erroneous, but not necessarily harmful to souls. So there could be some cases where there might be something in the private revelation that isn't necessarily true. And that's not within the charism of the Pope's infallibility. He's not proposing that as infallible. But he can't approve something universally as far as a private revelation that would be destructive to souls. So, for example, Our Lady of Fatima. This has, of course, been approved by the Church. If you were to accept the message of repentance and pray the rosary, which is the message of Fatima, is that going to be harmful to souls? It couldn't be, because it has been approved by the Church universally. Another plot twist here is when you start having private revelations that are introduced into our liturgy. That's really interesting. So we have the Feast of Our Lady of Fatima introduced into our liturgy.
Oh, yeah.
So you have an additional element here, because our liturgy informs our faith. So when you start introducing it into the liturgy, it is going to impact our faith above the level of just merely private revelation.
What a wonderful question. It would not have occurred to me, but I am so happy we got that question, Rick. We got to take a quick break. As you can hear, we'll be right back with more with Michael Lofton on papal infallibility. Looking forward to hearing from Catholics and non-Catholics alike. You're welcome to call 888-318-7884.
Catholic Answers Live.
Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Can you defend the Church's teaching on the real presence of Christ in the Eucharist? Do you desire a deeper relationship with our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament? Join us September 22nd through 25th for the annual Catholic Answers Conference in San Diego. This year's theme is the Eucharist, I Am With You Always. Featuring all the Catholic Answers speakers and special guest Bishop Thomas Papraki, use promo code EARLY to save $50 when you register at CatholicAnswersConference.com.
Want to know more about the origins of the Catholic Church? Joe Heschmeyer explores the beginnings of Christianity in The Early Church Was the Catholic Church. Joe digs deep into the words and actions of those who lived right after the apostles to refute anti-Catholic claims of how the faith was lived back then. Order your copy of The Early Church Was the Catholic Church today at shop.catholic.com or get it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Second hour, as promised, Rylene Simpson will be here. We're going to talk about accompanying those with same-sex attraction. If that's an issue for you or for a family member or for someone else that you are concerned about, perfect hour. Rylene is very helpful in a very very Catholic way, in a very practical way. She's very helpful. So hang on for that second hour. This hour, we're talking about papal infallibility. And this is one that either seems to baffle people or kind of bother people. It does seem a bit odd. It's something that Catholics certainly kind of get teased about in the wider culture, this idea of papal infallibility. I suppose it doesn't comport well with the egalitarian spirit of our times, that everybody's supposed to be equal in everything. Wait, you're telling me there's a guy in Rome who sometimes I have to take what he says as divinely revealed truth? Well, Yeah, you do. Because not everybody is equal in everything. Is that right to say divinely revealed? I mean, is that the way to think about infallibility?
He can certainly teach something that has been divinely revealed as infallible. Mm-hmm. He can also teach infallibly on things that are not divinely revealed, insofar as they are necessary to maintain to preserve something that is divinely revealed.
So
he has two objects of infallibility there. Something that is revealed by God in sacred scripture tradition, of course, he could propose that as infallible, and then also something that is not revealed by God but is connected to it. So, for example, papal canonizations. When a pope canonizes someone as a saint, God never revealed that so-and-so is a saint. However, the pope can teach it infallibly, not because God has divinely revealed it in Scripture,
yeah,
but because it relates to something that's in Scripture, and that is the indefectibility of our worship in our liturgical life. That the idea of us venerating somebody who's in hell on our altars is would basically give up the indefectibility of the church in our worship. So that is related to something then in sacred scripture, though so-and-so being a saint, Padre Pio being a saint, was never revealed in the Bible, for example.
Yeah. The number is 888-318-7884. Your questions welcome. Your challenges welcome. If you'd like to talk about papal infallibility, Michael likes talking about this stuff. As a matter of fact, he's
I love it.
Writing his doctoral dissertation on this very topic. So don't feel like he's going to break if you got to challenge him a little bit. He enjoys it. Give him a call, 888-318-7884. Up next, we're going to Pennsylvania. Walt in Pennsylvania, listening on Holy Spirit Radio. We're glad you're here, Walt. Go ahead with your question for Michael. Walt?
Can you hear me?
Oh, I got you now, Walt. Go ahead.
Unfortunately, I'm on a cell phone, and it's... I'm sitting still. Hopefully, I had good signal.
Don't move, Walt. Just stay right where you are and get that question out.
So, in any event, the question is, Pope John Paul issued a statement on the church's inability to ordain women. I can't remember if it was in an encyclical or an apostolic letter. And he said that the church has no authority to ordain women to holy orders. And the faithful are supposed to hold this definitively and with certain faith, words to that effect. Was that an infallible statement? And mm-hmm. if so, why are people still pushing for women to be ordained as priests, deacons, etc.?
Excellent question. This is one of my favorite questions because you're talking about the document Ordinatio Sacerdotalis in 1994 promulgated by John Paul II. This is a curious case. Because long story short, it first of all says that women cannot be ordained to the priesthood, and this is excluded by sacred scripture. So already on the basis of scripture, this is infallibly excluded. It gets worse. He also says that by what's called the Ordinarian Universal Magisterium, this is also excluded, which means that the constant teaching of the bishops spread throughout the world have consistently opposed this teaching. In other words, it's infallibly taught by the bishops spread throughout the world, which is another reason why one could not accept the ability to ordain women to the priesthood. And then lastly, he uses language that really sounds ex cathedra. If you read the very end of the document, he says this, I just pulled it up, "Wherefore, in order that all doubt may be removed regarding a matter of great importance, a matter which pertains to the church's divine constitution itself, in virtue of my ministry of confirming the brethren, I declare that the church has no authority whatsoever to confer priestly ordination on women, and that this judgment is to be definitively held by all the church's faithful." Now, when we speak of papal infallibility, the criteria to know what is taught by the Pope infallibly is laid out by the First Vatican Council. And the criteria that they give us is present in this document, which is why some theologians argue that this is ex cathedra. Some other theologians have said, no, this is not ex cathedra, not because it doesn't meet the description of Vatican II, but because they're adding additional requirements, I'm sorry, Vatican I, they're adding additional requirements that Vatican I doesn't give us for papal infallibility. For example, they'll say, you can't teach something infallibly that was already taught infallibly. But that's an arbitrary argument, because there's many instances where the church has done just that. So long story short, it really does seem to be something that falls within papal infallibility. And any argument against it, I think, has fallen short. But even if you want to say, okay, this is not taught by the Pope infallibly, it's still taught by Scripture infallibly, it's still taught by the bishops infallibly, therefore it's excluded. So anybody who wants to maintain that it's still open, frankly, it's just because they're in dissent from the magisterium of the church. That's what it boils down to.
What do you think, Walt?
Amen. And same thing with the diaconate, because that's holy orders. Why do the people keep pushing for women deacons?
So in this document, it only speaks of the priesthood, but I would say it applies also to the diaconate by extension of the logic that he uses. So I would say it also applies to deaconesses. Historically, there have been deaconesses, but they were never ordained. So they served in very particular cases in a non-sacramental way. So we see deaconesses in the New Testament. We see deaconesses in the Western Church until pretty late. We see them in the Eastern Church in the first millennium until pretty late. In fact, some of the Eastern Church is still have them, but they're not considered to be ordained sacramentally in the way that a deacon is. So we would say they're not part of actual holy orders. So anybody who wants to say that women should be raised to the diaconate, to actual holy orders, that is without precedent. And I think that's excluded by this document as well.
Walt, thank you very, very much. Appreciate the question. We're talking about papal infallibility with Michael Lofton this afternoon. If you have a question about papal infallibility, if you have a challenge to the Catholic understanding of papal infallibility, you're very welcome to call 888-318-7884. We go now to Mark in Detroit, Michigan, listening on 990 AM. Glad to have you, Mark. Go ahead with your question for Michael.
Hello. Thanks for having me on. I just wanted to offer a challenge to Michael in the context of something he said about if a pope says something that's not true, I don't agree that when something is said it's not true is not necessarily harmful to souls. That goes against Catholic philosophy. It goes against natural law. It goes against the first principle of philosophy, which is the law of non-contradiction. I do not agree with Michael on that. I wanted to hear what he thinks about that.
Yeah, so let me make sure that I'm clear on what I'm saying, because there's a sense in which I would agree with you, but let me be clear on what I'm saying. First, when we're talking about harmful to souls, we're talking about something that would take us off track from going to heaven, and if we were to assent to it, we would go to hell. That is not something that a pope could do in his office as pope. And that's excluded by a document called Donum Veritatis, where it deals with the entire mission of the church, and it speaks about how there is divine assistance of the Holy Spirit for the an integral mission of the entire church, which would include even things outside of ex cathedra. Also, John Paul II spoke about this kind of infallible safety that I'm referring to in some general audiences. So we're talking about in limited cases where he's teaching as pope, not a private individual. He would not be able to say something that's harmful or destructive to souls. That being said, could the pope do something that is harmful to souls when he's not acting as pope? Yeah, he could. So, for example, a pope could act not as a pope, but just as a private individual and do something that's scandalous. And that could cause people to fall away from the faith, seeing that scandal. Well, that's certainly harmful to souls. But we're only talking about a divine assistance of the Holy Spirit in cases of what he actually is promulgating for the church universally. And as far as something that is just a proposition that is not true, you're saying that a proposition that is not true is harmful to souls. Some of them could be, but I gave you an instance where some of them might not be. 2 + 2 = 5. That would not necessarily be something that would make you go to hell if you accepted that proposition. So it just depends on what we mean. But again, I'm basing what I'm saying here on the magisterium itself. It tells us these things. So I don't think that there's room for us to be able to say that the church could, for example, implement a liturgy universally or a disciplinary decree that's harmful to souls. I just think that that's outside of what the magisterium has said.
What do you think, Mark?
I think that there's room still for debate to that, because there's a few things that I could respond to what you're saying, Michael. One of them about scandal, and that a pope, I believe, even acting as pope can cause scandal. And also, I think that there can be times when there's ambiguous teachings, such as Amoris Laetitia on fornicating couples, and that and then in addition to that, I also think that something that a pope does doesn't necessarily cause someone to go to hell, but at the same time, what they do can be harmful to souls and lead them towards that direction. So anyone that goes to hell, it's the consequences of their own actions. You can't blame the pope for that. However, I think it's really dangerous to say that a pope is incapable of stating a lie in the office of the pope. There's something in there I think we have to be more careful about.
Michael?
Well, I definitely didn't say that he's incapable of stating a lie in the office of pope, but what I did say is that the church itself teaches that there's a divine protection and assistance of the Holy Spirit, even in non-ex cathedra teachings of the church. So my challenge to you would be, how do you reconcile what you're saying with the church itself says about itself? Moreover, as far as Amoris Laetitia and things like that, as far as scandal, and as far as problems, I think those arise from improper implementations of papal documents and misreports about papal documents rather than the actual substance of the document itself.
Mark, I appreciate your objections and your challenges. I imagine this conversation could go on for a while. I have to go to a break, however. I actually find this part of the conversation very, very interesting, because I think there's many subtle things to flesh out, and I wish we had the time to do it, but we don't. Mark, we got to take this break. We'll be right back with more conversation about papal infallibility with Michael Lofton right after this.
This is Archbishop Paul Coakley, the Archdiocese of Oklahoma City, and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
Do you love praying for people? Have you ever wanted to use your gift of prayer to share Jesus with others and build up the body of Christ? Start a public prayer station with St. Paul Street Evangelization. Listen to people's needs, pray with them, or invite them to meet you at church. St. Paul Street Evangelization can help you get started. Find out how at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
This is Toya Hall, Vice President of the Guadalupe Radio Network. Catholic Radio has the power to transform people's lives by proclaiming the fullness of truth with love and clarity. Catholic Radio equips the faithful to address the problems that face our world today and from a uniquely Catholic perspective. Daily doses of Catholic Radio helps to build strong and faithful souls for Holy Mother Church.
The world needs EWTN Catholic Radio, now more than ever.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. We're talking about papal infallibility with Michael Lofton. Enjoying that conversation, and I am going back to the phones. But I want to just give a little bit more play to what our last caller, Mark, was about, because it's interesting. I my sense is, if I had asked Mark, and I didn't have time to have this conversation, but he referred to Amoris Laetitia, and so there's a sense that, but what if what the Pope is doing, in other words, I think he's not happy with the job that Pope Francis is doing. Okay, so is it possible to reconcile what you said, that the Pope can't do things that objectively are harmful for souls, but a person also at the same time hold the position that Mark holds, that Pope Francis is doing a bad job?
Yeah, I mean, we could certainly say that a pope is not doing a good job, that he's being imprudent, that he's implementing things that are not timely or that are not effective, that are not necessarily the most conducive for souls. We can certainly say that. What I'm referring to is strictly in the context of what he's promulgating universally in matters of discipline and liturgy. Specifically, that's all I'm limiting, because that's all the church is limiting this guidance and safety of the Holy Spirit to. Yeah. Outside of that, there's a lot of room for mistakes on part of the Pope, and I think we've seen that from some popes.
Yeah, but you can't have the Pope, the Pope couldn't promulgate a liturgy for the entire world that was, that worshipped Satan or something, that did something that... It can't happen. The Holy Spirit will protect the church from that.
Right. And some people will say, well, that's not ex cathedra, so I mean, I guess he can't. No, that's also not permitted, because even though he's not speaking ex cathedra, maybe I'm promulgating this liturgy, he's promulgating a liturgy in our worship that would be destructive to our souls. And the church teaches that the church itself is protected by the Holy Spirit in its faith, governance, and worship, insofar as it's necessary to carry out its mission in this world. And our liturgy is certainly necessary to carry out the mission in this world, as far as bringing us to heaven. And so he could not implement a liturgy that is destructive to souls itself. That doesn't mean that some aspects of that liturgy couldn't be imprudent. They certainly could be.
Got it. Anne in Colorado. Watching on YouTube, you are up next, Anne. Go ahead with your question for Michael Lofton.
Well, Hi. Good afternoon. Thank you. I'm sure glad I like this topic, and I'm glad that you're here talking about it. What I would like to know is that I have been told by many people that the new Mass cannot be because a pope solidified it and said this Mass could never be changed, which is the old Latin Mass, can never be changed. And I wanted to know, is that true?
I was a little confused by that question, but you're clear on it, Michael?
I'm very clear.
Could you just reiterate then for me? Just
sure.
For me, I might be the only one that was confused by it.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, the caller is asking about a document, Quo Primum, by Pius V. And so in Quo Primum, what some people are saying is they're saying that the Pope indicates that the Latin Mass is the only liturgy that can be celebrated in the Roman Rite, and no Pope can undo this. No Pope can reverse this or change it or alter this missal. That's the claim. However, if you look at Quo Primum, what Pius V actually is indicating is that no one beneath his authority could alter that missal. So no bishop, no cardinal, nobody else, aside from a pope, could alter it. He doesn't say aside from a pope, because that's already understood that one pope cannot bind another pope on a matter of discipline. So it's already understood by Pius V that he's not speaking of a successor undoing his missal. He's speaking about people below the office of a pope. They cannot alter the missal on their own. It's curious that Pius V himself alters his own missal. So he himself, if he had intended to say that this could never be altered after Quo Primum's promulgated, well, he altered his own missal. And there were other successive popes who also altered similar aspects to it. The same kind of words is used for promulgating the breviary, and yet that was also altered by Pius X. And so it was always understood that one pope could never bind another pope on a matter of discipline. So it was understood that Quo Primum was to be binding on everyone aside from a pope who were to say, I'm going to reverse this. And in the case of Paul VI, who, you know, made some alterations to the missal in the Roman Rite, in the document where he does this, in the very apostolic constitution where he, you know, gives us the Novus Ordo Missae, he quotes Quo Primum. So he's aware of Quo Primum. He's aware of what Pius V said. So Paul VI doesn't see a problem with it, anything that Pius VI says. I'm sorry, Pius V, because Paul VI knows that one pope cannot bind another pope in matters of discipline. The only thing a pope could bind another pope to is in a matter of faith and morals, if the pope were to teach it infallibly. So no pope could now come out and say, you know what, the Immaculate Conception isn't true. Even though my predecessor taught it infallibly, it's not infallible anymore. No pope could do that because that relates to a matter of faith and morals that's been taught definitively. But discipline cannot be imposed definitively.
And what do you make of all that? Is that helpful to you?
Oh, absolutely. It's exactly what I thought, but I wanted an expert to tell me that. Thank you.
Well, have you got one. That Michael Lofton, he's pretty good at this. Thanks, Ann.
Yes. Thank you. Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. The number is 888-318-7884. We got a few minutes left to get to more calls. I'm going to go to another caller now, but I think if you call now, if you have you want to get something on with Michael, we can do that. Let's go to we're going back to Colorado, listening to EWTN on channel 130 Sirius XM satellite radio. Victor in Colorado. Victor, thanks for hanging on. Go ahead with your question for Michael.
Yeah. It's about the Holy Order, wherein the Pope said the Church can't do anything about any change on that plan.
Yes.
And from what I've learned, all the sacraments actually could not be changed or cannot be changed by the Church because it was Christ himself that instituted it. So ordaining women is out of the question.
Yeah, and I wrote an article on this maybe a month ago or so for Catholic Answers that you'll certainly want to check out. I think it was something like Doritos for the Eucharist, ? In other words, could a pope change bread and wine for the Eucharist to Doritos and Pepsi? Which the answer is no, he couldn't. But that's the name of the article. You'll want to check it out because it touches on this in more details. But what the Church teaches is the substance of the sacrament is fixed, and they are instituted by Christ. The substance of the sacraments. So we could never change the substance. However, the Church also notes that the Church is allowed some leeway in altering the matter and form of some of the sacraments, to an extent that it doesn't alter the substance of the sacrament. So, in other words, there have been plenty of cases where the Catholic Church actually has altered the form of a sacrament, the matter of a sacrament, or both, but never to the extent that this substance has changed so that we've gone from bread and wine to Doritos and Pepsi in the Eucharist. That's too far because we've changed the actual substance now of what's being used for the Eucharist. So there is some wiggle room for the Church to make some changes here in reference to the sacraments, but never in a way that would change their substance.
I think particularly, unless I'm mistaken, I think particularly with the sacrament of confirmation, in which I don't know that there is a biblical clarity on what the matter is. The Church is, but I could be mistaken on that. I think that's a sacrament that it's entirely in the hands of the Church to decide how someone is confirmed.
Yeah, the Church has made some alterations here, and what's even more curious is we have differences between Eastern and Western Catholic churches.
Yeah.
Among our rites, we have differences when it comes to some of the form of some of the sacraments.
Yeah.
But those are allowed because they don't change the substance of the sacraments. So the differences that we might have in some of the forms of the sacraments isn't so great that it changes the entire thing.
Oh, yeah. I'm thinking of with the sacrament of confession, moving from public to private confession, moving from public penances to private penances.
Another example here is...
I'm very in favor of both of those, by the way.
Yeah. Another example here is that, you know, baptisms used to be in the nude, whereas they're not now. You know, there's all kinds of things that changed with baptisms and all kinds of sacraments. So
it makes that Saturday vigil mass before Easter much more interesting. But actually, some people have suggested that that's why they used the term deaconess, was that because the women were and men were naked, so you had to have men assisting men and women assisting women.
Exactly, because it wasn't proper for a man to see the woman, right?
Victor, what do you think? You satisfied with that answer?
Yes, that makes it clear. Thank you.
All right, thank you very, very much. Coming up next, Rylene Simpson will be here. We're going to talk about accompanying those with same-sex attraction. We're also just going to have a great visit with Rylene because she's an awesome person to visit with. So we hope you'll join us for that hour. Michael, you're continuing to do great work. Would you just real quick let people know where they can find your work?
Yeah, if you just go to YouTube, type in Reason and Theology, you'll see the channel come up, or just go to reasonandtheology.com.
And Michael's also an associate apologist here at Catholic Answers, an association that I'm hoping will just go on and on and on and on. Is it? It's not still like month to month, right? It's not like one of those
It's longer than that.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Yeah. Good. Yeah. So, at some of our events, you'll see Michael, and you'll certainly read his materials on Catholic Answers Magazine online and Catholic in the pages of the paper Catholic Answers Magazine. We're very grateful for that association. Are you a Catholic Answers speaker too, or when people want you for a speaker, they got to go somewhere else?
I'm open to it.
Oh, okay. So you can go through our Catholic Answer Speakers website to get you.
I don't think I've been added yet, but I'm open to it. So.
Oh, I didn't know. Oh, yeah. Okay. All right. Yeah. Well, all right. I got 4 minutes at the break. We'll negotiate a salary for you for that. All right. Well, we're going to take a quick break. And as I said, be right back with Rylene Simpson. It's always a great conversation. It's something that's quite pressing. Also, I'm sure there may be questions having to do with the transgender movement and all that and how we address those things. Rylene, a wonderful person to talk to. We'll do that right after this on Catholic Answers Live. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. As promised, Rylene Simpson is here with us, born and raised a Catholic. She did stray from the faith, as many of us do, in her teen years, lived the gay and lesbian lifestyle for almost 30 years with a live-in partner for 25, reverted back to the faith in 2009. Now she's a Courage member, a moderator of an Encourage support group, and you probably know her as one of the three people who were profiled in the wonderful movie Desire of the Everlasting Hills. Rylene Simpson, thanks for being with us.
It is a pleasure to be here, and welcome back to the microphone.
Thank you. Thank you. I am so happy to be back. It's just nice. So the Courage Conference is going on right now. So how is it that we have you here with us when the Courage Conference is going on right now?
You know, this is the first year since I joined Courage since my first Courage Conference. I think it was in 2010. I haven't been able to be there, but just circumstances and life and a person visiting my house that I hadn't seen in quite a while, and so needed to stay here. That's okay. That's all right. I'm sure they're doing just fine without me.
less fine, I'm sure, however. The number here is 888-318-7884. If same-sex attraction is something that you are dealing with in your life and you'd like to talk about it, maybe a family member, maybe you have a general question. All are welcome with Rylene. She's happy to take your questions. 888-318-7884. 888-318-7884. All right. We mentioned Courage, Encourage, and the Courage Conference, and I'm sure there are people who don't know what those things are. So maybe tell us about that, and then we'll get you some calls.
Yeah, that's a good place to start. So Encourage is I would call it a mission or an apostolate of the Catholic Church that supports people who experience same-sex attractions but want to live faithful to the Catholic Church and to not act on our desires. And very faithful to the Church, people who are working on chastity and maintaining chastity. And so it's a support group, and there are local chapters, and we meet regularly and, support one another and build up chaste, healthy same-sex friendships is really a core value to Courage. And then Encourage is a co-apostolate under the umbrella of Courage, and Encourage is for the support of people whose kids, family members, friends are in the gay lifestyle and who, you know, want to get together and pray for them, but also need support, need to understand what the issues are, need to understand how to stay in relationship with their kids or their brother, sister, cousin, niece, and how to support them without giving up their own principled understanding of human sexuality.
Again, 888-318-7884, the number 888-318-7884. You know, something that last bit that you said, it seems to me like that's a thing that the whole church needs to know how to do, how to be loving and supporting to people with same-sex attraction or who are living the life, but to do so in a way that doesn't surrender Christ's beautiful teachings on chastity.
Yeah, I think that's true. And, I think that people... You can see every response across the spectrum from very loving with no appreciation of the truth and then very truthful and maybe even, justice-based with no appreciation of the human person and the human feelings and everything in between when you're sitting in the pew in church. So I do think that it helps. I think that one of the important things that we're doing is right here today, talking about the issue. People are not generally, if you're not encountering it in your own family, very frequently you haven't given very much thought to the issue of homosexuality and how it impacts the individual, how it impacts their relationship with fellow human beings and their family relationships, but also their relationship with God. And so if you're not thinking about it, you probably haven't really delved into it deeply enough to form a informed response, right? So
yeah. This is
kind of hard for everybody.
I mean, I know I'm taking up your time, and there are lots of folks who want to talk to you already, so I'm going to get to them. But I've been mulling this ever, I guess, since the beginning of June, maybe this year. June, I think, is Pride Month everywhere. I don't know if it's Pride Month everywhere, but you get here in San, yeah, I guess so. It's everywhere, probably. Big corporations, and it's just become a kind of almost like a litmus test that everyone's trying to pass. You know, Target's got to be, and then Walmart's got to be, and everyone's trying to out Pride one another. And
your local Catholic church or your local Catholic school.
Right. And so
flying flag, yeah.
Here's the thing that I'm struggling with is that I think a lot of people want to stand up to what they see as the gay agenda or the homosexual agenda or the sexual revolution agenda. And I'm sympathetic to that, but the actual gay people that I know, they're not, that's not them. I mean, they may participate in that even, or even celebrate all that, but I want a church that responds to them, not as members of a great movement or something that's challenging us or that's challenging the faith, but I'm not articulating this question very well, Rileen, but
no, I think you are.
I feel like I'm stuck on somewhere.
I think you're getting there, right?
Okay, get me there. Yeah.
And in the church, so there's two layers to the situation. And what you're talking about is, you know, there's the whole public arena, political lobbying, all of that layer of stuff that's about the gay agenda. But then there are the individuals who are our neighbors, our brothers, our sisters, our cousins, aunts and uncles, and so on. But the church does deal at those two levels. So the church's doctrine addresses that gay movement, gay agenda. So when the church publishes in the catechism that homosexual people who experience homosexual feelings are to be respected, given full dignity, just like every other human, that's dealing with the person. And then when it says, but the behavior is sinful and should be avoided, and that is dealing with the kind of the doctrinal level that addresses the transgender movement, the homosexual, the gay agenda movement, and all those kinds of things. We deal at the doctrine level, and those issues are stated there. But then pastorally, it's our job to address the human one-on-one person in the pew level. So,
yeah, okay. All right, you do have a bunch of questions. You know what? I'll tell you what, folks on the phone, if you just hang on a quick minute, I'll get this first break out of the way real fast, and then we'll come back. There's a couple lines open as well. If you have questions about the Catholic idea of accompanying those with same-sex attraction, if you want to know the truth about what the Catholic Church teaches, about what Jesus himself teaches, you're very welcome to call 888-318-7884. Right back with more of that right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
Miss a show? Make sure to catch up by downloading the podcast, available online at Catholic.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects homebuyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
One of the reasons we should go to Mass is because it is the food of the saints that we receive. And for the saints, they understood rightly that the time after Holy Communion, that those moments are the most precious moments of our lives.
The Holy Sacrifice of the Mass, live from the EWTN Chapel, every morning, 8 Eastern, on EWTN Radio and Television.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. Line's filling up. Just one open now. You're welcome to call and talk with our guest, Rileen Simpson, 888-318-7884. If you haven't seen the movie Desire of the Everlasting Hills, she is one of the folks featured in it. It's a beautiful movie. Very, very helpful movie in understanding what the Catholic faith is trying to offer all of us. And that's the only way I can think about it. It's what the Catholic faith is there to offer to all of us. And this is about three different people living in what you might say homosexual lifestyle, or however you, whatever language you prefer, and discovering in that context the beauty of what Christ and His Church are offering us. I highly recommend it to you, and it's very inexpensive. As a matter of fact, just type in Desire of the Everlasting Hills, and they'll show it to you for free. Anne in Vancouver, Washington, you are listening on Modern Day Radio. You are up first today. Anne, go ahead with your question for our guest, Rylene Simpson.
Thank you, Rylene. Thank you very much for your ministry. I wanted to ask what you think about the Catholic Campaign for Human Development giving money through grants to organizations, including One Community United, that's known for promoting homosexuality, transgenderism, and drag queen story time.
I haven't checked out the Campaign for Human Development for a while, so I don't know specifically those things, or you know how recently that is, but of course when we give to those kind of Catholic causes, our hope and our prayer is that our funds are going to support Catholic causes. So of course those types of events would be contrary to our faith. My recommendation, I mean, you know, there's, my opinion doesn't count for that much. It doesn't have any more weight than yours does or size does, I'm afraid. But I do think that when we find documentation that recognizes organizations, you know, that are giving our Catholic money away to non-Catholic, anti-Catholic causes, I would guess I would call that, I do think it behooves us to bring it up to, in a quiet, calm way, to the bishop whose funds are being distributed that way. So,
Anne?
Yeah, I reached out today. I reached out today to our archdiocesan office, to the people coordinating the CCHD. And so hopefully I'll get an answer, because I don't like Catholic money going to programs that directly contradict Catholic teaching.
Well, yeah, that's but that has been, I mean, sometimes we're dealing with large sums of money, and not always the person in charge of it or the people in charge of it are the people who should be. I do think this is a constant battle for bishops, so I hope they'll keep fighting it. But thank you, Anne. Thanks very much. I had not heard of that particular one, so I don't want to say more about that particular one, but like you were saying at the beginning, you know, with many Catholic institutions, you never know what you're going to get on the much of this stuff, Rylene.
Yeah, I'm afraid that's the case. You know, as we're a patchwork, Catholic Church is made up of human beings.
Yeah,
and
right.
One of us has an opinion, so.
Again, the number's 888-31-TRUTH. I'm going to go to Cassie in St. Louis, Missouri, listening on Covenant Radio. Cassie, thank you for calling. Go ahead with your question for Rylene Simpson.
Hi, Rylene. Wanted to ask you, I also was in the lifestyle for 17 years, and about 10 years ago, I had a pretty amazing hinge moment and came back to the church, and Catholic Answers was actually a really huge part of me learning all the beautiful whys behind the whats. And
welcome home. Welcome back home.
Thank
right?
you. Thank
and
you.
I'll agree with you. Catholic Answers was important to me too. Very important to me.
Oh, that's really cool. So, you know, I'm at a point now in my journey where, you know, I completely embrace the church and all her teachings, and I've started sharing my story in recent years, and I'm starting to get asked to share my story to, like, you know, high school groups or other groups. But sometimes I come up against Catholics who will throw up Father James Martin or Father Richard Rohr and say, well, they're priests and they're singing a different tune. So my question to you is, you know, I don't want to be combative. I don't want to just be like, they're dissidents, right? Like, how do you respond to that?
Right. Yeah, so it's a great question. And I think that I always go back to the Catechism, and because the Catechism, I think, expresses the Catholic Church's position very beautifully. There, as I said a minute ago, everybody's got their opinion in the Church, but the Church itself publishes its teaching. We don't have to guess, and we don't have to monitor headliners who are, you know, promoting what it's promoting. We don't have to look for interpretation around, you know, and see if who thinks what about the Church teaches. The Church's teaching is the Church's teaching, and I think we have to give people allowance. We're all at different stages in our personal journey towards salvation, and I guess I would say we don't know the state of anybody else's soul. Even educated priests can be misguided in many ways. You know, they're very well educated, but there was an era where the teaching of the Church got pretty confused and confusing. Not the actual teachings of the Church, but the teaching arm of the Church, the seminaries. You know, there was an area that was, there was a lot of upheaval in the 60s, 70s, 80s. So there's a lot of confusion out there. We have to be charitable towards the Father Martins, the Richard Rohrs of the world, etc. We have to pray for them and any dissident priests. But, you know, they're not the, that's not how the Church promulgates its teachings, you know, not through them. It's through the teaching office. So,
Cassie, what do you think?
I think that you gave me some good nuggets that are gentle and true.
Yeah. I really like that part about the Catholic Church publishes what it teaches. You don't, you don't have to guess at it. And so it's easy to tell when someone's teaching it, what is contrary to it. Although, Cassie, I'm going to say thanks very, very much. I'm going to keep going. But that's I suppose, what I was trying to get at with my struggle, because I don't know Father Rohr's writing. I know a little bit of Father Martin's writing. And one thing I do appreciate about Father Martin is the desire that everyone know that God loves them. I really think, and I know the critiques, and I'm not trying, I really don't want to elide the critiques or anything. But I do want to go, yeah, but I'm totally with him on that. That this idea that God loves.
I think he's very sincere in that. Yeah. I agree with you.
Yeah.
He's very sincere. He's a little misguided, but he truly wants everybody to feel God's love. I agree.
Yeah. Okay. Cassie, thanks. I'm going to Teresa in Louisiana, listening to EWTN on channel 130, Sirius XM satellite radio. Teresa, go ahead with your question for our guest, Rylene Simpson.
Hi. First of all, thank you all so much for talking about this, because I don't really hear this very often when I watch EW or when I hear, like, Catholic radio stuff, so it's really cool to hear about it.
Well, now we're going to have Rylene on more. He's saying that. She's going to say, see, you need to have me on more. So, all right. It's going to be at least once a month we should have you on, Rylene. Why are we waiting so long between visits?
All right. Carry on, Teresa.
So I would actually kind of like some advice, because this past June, I know y'all talked about Pride Month a little bit at the beginning.
Yeah.
First of all, I'm a performer, and I perform in a monthly arts market in my town, and it's a job for me. You know, it is a job. I am Catholic before I'm anything else, so nobody ever really has to know about my sexuality, my sexual preferences. And people know me around here as an artist, and they respect me as an artist. When June rolled around this year, I showed up for my regular gig, and the woman, she was very sweet. She said, oh, I don't think we're going to have you on this month, just for this month, because we're really trying to open up the floor for more LGBTQ voices. And it really made me feel, like, strange, because I realized at any moment I could say, well, you know, I experienced those attractions, and she would have said, oh, then that's fine. Like, that's totally fine. And there would have been no problem. But instead, I just kind of held my tongue because I didn't know if it was to say it or not as a Catholic, if that would have been right. So I really don't know how to, you know, deal with those two aspects.
Oh, this is a really interesting question, right?
Yeah.
Because it could have opened up a real discussion, you know, something really meaningful. And I think that when, for whatever reason, saying the words same-sex attraction is a turnoff in that community for everybody. So if you had said, like, if you had said, I also experience same-sex attraction, then she would have said, well, do you mean you're gay?
Yeah.
Because people don't understand that same-sex attraction thing. It's like, well, no, you have to say, you know, you have to wave the flag and say you're gay. I think it would have been, yeah, I think that was a very awkward kind of thing for her to foist on you, right? It's like, well, we're going to, well, you know, people who are in charge of these kind of venues, they set the rules and the criteria. I don't know that I would have said it myself. If I had been in your situation, I might not have said, well, I also experience same-sex attractions. Because I think that's, you know, to me, and, you know, I think each generation, succeeding generation, sees it differently, but for me, that's my private information. If I'm in that situation where I'm experiencing those, I don't really want to know, frankly, among all my friends and acquaintances, what their sexual attractions are. It's none of my business. And so I think I would have held off and let it go and offered up that work that you bypassed. I would have offered that up as a suffering, you know. Offer it up. That's what my mother would have said. Offer it up. And so I don't mean to be callous, but I think that it was a sacrifice. And but if you were sitting, if it didn't have to do with work or something like that, and you were sitting talking to that same person at a bar or having dinner with them or chatting with them or knew them to the extent that you know, you had kind of a non-commercial relationship with them, then I think I would be more inclined to, you know, if that came up in that context that we're looking for these kinds of people for June, whatever, then I might have opened the discussion to something like, well, tell me more about that, you know, and what about the people who experience that and don't act out on it? And, you know, there are lots of those people in the world. I'm one of them. You know, if when you're in a relationship with somebody, it's different, a personal relationship rather than, you know, a commercial relationship. I'm not, you know.
Yeah.
Those are my thoughts.
What are your thoughts, Teresa?
I definitely agree. And it really made me feel disheartened. Because of the fact that it's supposed to be an inclusive, it was all in the name of inclusion, you know, when they wanted to put, to yeah. uplift those other voices. And yet the irony is that, you know, they're leaving a lot of people out.
Awful lot of people get excluded in the name of inclusion. That seems to be the pattern. Can you imagine if somebody said, oh, we're only having conservative Christians dancing or performing this week? I mean, people would be outraged. but no, you can do it the other way, and there is no outrage. So, and I agree. I don't. At least to me, Riley, and I thought your answer was very sensible. We don't want to just become part of the outrage and upset. Sometimes you just have to say, well, that's the way the world is now, and I'll come back next month.
Yeah.
You all right, Teresa?
Sunday. Yes,
all
I
right.
am.
All right.
It's a lot to think about.
Boy, is it. Yeah, boy, is it. I'm very grateful for your call. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you for calling in. It was a great question.
Yeah. 888-318-7884 is our number. 888-318-7884. Lots of folks on the line. I think we can get another call in before we have to do a break. Let's go to Sherry Ann in Georgia, listening on Ablaze Radio. That's an awesome name. Sherry Ann, go ahead with your question for Rylene Simpson.
Hi, thank you for taking my call. My question is really advice on what is the best thing to do in this situation. So, longtime friend, daughter is getting married, who we also have known her whole life. She has decided she would like to marry a girl. My friend... friend, my husband's friend, the father is Catholic, and my husband and I are very faithful, and we're just not sure how we feel about this situation and wondered what really is the best thing for us to do.
Well, when you say you're not sure how you feel about it, are you struggling with the idea of you're invited to the wedding and you don't know whether to go? Are you thinking maybe positive things about, so, okay.
I'll tell you what, with that clarification, we got to take a quick break if you don't mind. Can you hang on a quick second, Sherri-Ann, and we'll get an answer
for
you?
Sure.
All right. Rylene Simpson is our guest. We're talking about accompanying those with same-sex attraction from the Catholic perspective, and as Catholics, if you'd like to get in on that conversation, whether you're Catholic or not, give us a call, 888-318-7884.
Here's a question. Is it really possible to be friends with someone who died 2,000 years ago? Maybe the problem is that we've grown way too comfortable with the story of Jesus. Nice man, right? Taught us to love one another, said not to judge people. We celebrate his birthday every year. It's time to put away this small, safe version of Jesus, says Cy Kellett. Nobody that bland could have transformed the world. In A Teacher of Strange Things, Cy presents Jesus Christ undiluted by sentiment, with all his radical words and deeds uncensored. Do you know someone, your son or daughter perhaps, or maybe your mom or dad, who needs the friendship of Jesus Christ? Do you? Order your copy of A Teacher of Strange Things by visiting shop.catholic.com today or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you. Have you enrolled in the Catholic Answers School of Apologetics? Let me ask you a more important question. Do you believe as a Catholic that you have an obligation to share the Catholic faith? In fact, the Church has answered this question, and the answer is that all confirmed Catholics are obliged to share the faith. It's actually in canon law. Catholic Answers is here to help you fulfill that obligation. Our School of Apologetics courses will equip you to help all the people you come in contact with understand what the Church teaches and why. A great place to start is with all the Catholics in your life. Learn the art of apologetics from the best of the best and start sharing the gospel today. Visit schoolofapologetics.com. That's schoolofapologetics.com.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
Welcome back, Catholic Answers Live. Sherri-Ann from Georgia is on the line. Our guest is Rylene Simpson. The question has to do with family members about to be married. I believe it's two women. Or did I get that wrong?
I think it's friends of the family, right?
Sherri-Ann, you got to help me. I guess I messed the story up. But friends of the family or family members?
Friends of the family.
And it's two women.
Yes, and you know, we love the whole family and want to support them, and just wondering what's the right thing for us to do in that situation if you're invited to a wedding where two women are going to be married.
So I think that in our culture, we have gotten, we have a lot confused. You said that they're, at least the father of the young woman is Catholic, but one of the things that we get confused about the sacraments is that they're not just social engagements. These things are sacraments. So obviously this is not going to be a sacramental marriage, but marriage is a sacrament and confers graces on people. Baptism, you know, people hand out godparent cards for, to people who really, have no business being godparents a lot of times. So it's because they see it as some kind of social thing. When we attend, this is my opinion now, so, because the Church doesn't have a teaching about whether or not Catholics can attend a gay wedding, but in my opinion, our presence at an event that is supposed to be sacramental, but is that is reflecting a non-truth that these two women are going to be married. We're there as witnesses representing the Catholic community to witness to something that's not true. And for me, I cannot do that. And I know, you know, it's a struggle. We have a group called Encourage for the parents, friends, and family of people who struggle and maybe are living out the gay life. And in those meetings, it's always a struggle when the child decides they're going to marry a same-sex partner. And, you know, whether to go, if they don't go, is it going to destroy the relationship for the rest of their lives? All of those things have to be taken into account. But I think if you're... you know, if you're friends with this couple, having a frank talk, if you recognize in your own self that this is a non-truth, that this wedding is a lie, you don't have to use that harsh language that I just used, but if it would be helpful to share it with I think it would be helpful to share with the family, if you're deciding not to go, to share with them why. Calmly, before it ever happens, explaining how much you love the parents, how much you love the daughter, explaining how much you want the best for them, and why you think this is not the best for the young woman. But I guess it still wasn't clear. I mean, again, there's no teaching that you can't go to that wedding, so it is a prudential judgment.
Okay. Well, thank you.
Thank you.
I wish you the best. we'll say a prayer for your decision.
thank you.
Yeah, I think it's one of those. Sometimes I do think there's a kind of almost. Systematic thing about it, but it does seem that there's pushing the Christian person's buttons is part of modern society. So can I get you to bake the cake? Can I get you to come to the wedding? Can I get you to, you know, acquiesce to story hour, you know, all that. And the question is always, okay, well, where's the point at which I say no? That's I want to be loving and caring and open, but I'm not looking for any trouble. But there has got to be somewhere where the answer is no. That's just not. And people got to make it for themselves. There's not, like you said, there's not a lot of church teaching on it. You know, there's no. I don't believe there's any official church documents on. What's the story hour called? It's trans something.
Oh, it's drag.
Drag Queen Story Hour. Yeah, right. I've never seen the encyclical on Drag Queen Story Hour, so you got to figure that out for yourself. Is that where you should be as a Christian person? The number is 888-318-7884. Thanks, Sherry Ann. James in St. Louis, Missouri, listening on the Covenant Radio Network. You are up next, James. Go ahead with your question.
Yeah, thanks for taking my call. My wife and I are both Catholics, and our faith is very strong. Recently, though, we received in the mail a card for a baby shower, and it's for my wife's nephew. He is married to another guy. They got married in the state of Arizona, by the way, some time ago. I don't know how long ago it was, but it couldn't have been too long. But anyway, they are now adopting a baby girl. And I was infuriated myself when I saw it, and I thought, my first reaction is, if you send a gift down there for this baby shower, you are really promoting the homosexual lifestyle. Well, my wife doesn't seem to think that. Her take on it is, if she sends something, it's not for the two of them, it's for the baby itself. So that's the thing that's the conflict that we have right now, and I would appreciate some advice on what I just mentioned, if you would, please.
Yes, James, thank you for that. You very clearly stated what the problem is. And so we do have to differentiate. So it's similar to the last call, only different, right? because there is a third person involved, and that's the child. And so the you know, it's a very sad thing that these gentlemen are depriving the child of having a married mother and father. And so it's a very sad thing. It's very regrettable. I'm not sure if I would send a baby shower gift to be at the baby shower, but I don't think that I would deprive this child of gifts that you would give to any other nephew or niece, right? Or great nephew or niece in your relationship. I mean, I think that the birth should be, or the adoption itself, maybe doesn't need to be acknowledged, but if you're giving all the other nieces and nephews birthday presents or cards or whatever, the child has no choice in this matter and shouldn't be deprived of whatever love the family can give them. I think the most important thing is that the child be loved. And it sounds like your wife has a female heart, the heart of a mother, right? And so this little girl is going to need some women in her life. It doesn't sound like it looks like you're in Missouri and this is going on in Arizona. But if there were a way to be a benevolent force in the child's life, I think that would be very, very important. And if sending a gift gives you entryway to that, I think that would be a good thing to do. But again, there's no teaching on this, and it's only my opinion. But I can't resist a baby either, just like your wife.
Does that opinion help you, James?
Yes, it does.
Okay.
I suppose I'll give in to my wife's determination, let's put it that way, of what she wants to do on it. But it does infuriate me, though, in another way. But she, I don't know, maybe perhaps she does have a point. She says it's not for the two homosexuals, it's for the baby itself. And so, you know, her point, I suppose, is well taken, but I still feel uneasy about it.
I affirm your infuriation. They're depriving this child of a mother,
a
married mother and father. And so it is a situation that's infuriatable.
You made that up. Riley's making up words now.
I am. But it might be a seventh syllable. I'll have to check that later. But anyway, I understand your sentiment completely. It's perfectly justified. They're doing an injustice to this child. But those are the children we have to love even more, right? Don't you feel a little bit when there's a child who's a child of divorced parents, don't you feel like you need to give them a little bit extra? And this to me is like a parallel situation. This child's going to need some real loving from some traditional mother, father, relatives, and maybe you and your sainted wife are the two. And always prayers, right?
I think of the two of them, James is the saint in that relationship. You're promoting the wife to saint, but I think it's James.
I just didn't know the wife's name, so I had to give her a
But it, again, here's the thing is, okay, so you say, well, the church's teaching is clear, and live by that teaching, and then what, you're running a Catholic preschool, and maybe it's the only preschool in town, and the lesbian couple or the gay male couple come and want to put the child in this Catholic preschool, and you're going to face parents who will say, you can't do that because you're violating the witness of it, and other parents will say, you can't turn the child away. We don't turn children away. Jesus didn't turn. And everybody's going to have a moral reason. But the level of confusion, and also the level of very clear moral distinctions you have to make. Like, you even made a moral distinction in your answer to James that said, I wouldn't send it to the shower, but I would send it to the child separately. It's a very, very, it's morally fraught. It just is morally fraught. I don't know how else to say it.
Yeah.
You're not going to make up a word for it?
I could.
All right. Let's take a break. James, thanks for that tough question. We'll be right back with more with Rylene Simpson right after this.
There's only one. Catholic Answers Live.
We have a big problem. Our culture is dying, and souls are in danger of being lost. The answer is conversion to Jesus Christ in His church. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a Catholic organization, and we have hundreds of teams spreading the good news throughout the country. But we need your help. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
He is honored by the church as a saint with the title of the Seraphic Doctor.
Matthew Bunsen and the Doctors of the Church.
One of the greatest theologians and Franciscan mystics in church history, Bonaventure also wrote a biography of St. Francis that was commissioned by the Franciscans themselves. It took a saint and true mystic to understand a true saint and mystic. He died in 1274.
For more about the Doctors of the Church, visit doctorsofthechurch.com.
Welcome back, Catholic Answers Live. Having a good time finishing the week with Rylene Simpson, and we're talking about accompanying those with same-sex attraction, the levels of questions and the moral distinctions that need to be made are multiplying, and it's wonderful to have Rylene to help us through that. Rylene, just a real quick again, because I want to get it in before we go again, and I'm not confident that I will remember by the top of the hour. Tell people about Courage and Encourage and how they can get involved if this is something they'd like to do.
Wonderful. So Courage is a group that is a support group for people who feel same-sex attractions but don't want to act on them and want to live faithful to God's plan for human sexuality. And they can be reached at couragerc.org. Under that same website, you can find a group called Encourage, which is for parents, friends, and family, people with loved ones who are in the gay life, and it's a support group to help them maintain their relationships and still maintain their principled Catholic beliefs. And so that's Encourage, and that can be also found at the couragerc.org website.
And it is right now the Courage Conference is going on. So if you maybe in your prayers around the dinner table or evening prayers tonight, you'll remember the folks at the Courage Conference. Prayers always welcome. We go now to Tyler in Omaha, Nebraska, listening on Spirit Catholic Radio. Tyler, glad to have you here. Go ahead with your question for Rylene Simpson.
Hi. Thank you all for having me this evening.
We're happy to, Tyler.
Yeah, glad to have you.
Yeah, appreciate it. So, yes, I'm in Omaha, Nebraska, but I'm originally from Lower Alabama. So that's why I've already said y'all a couple of times. So I'm someone who, a little bit of an outlier being from Alabama, that I'm bisexual, and I had many same-sex relationships during my college years. But now I'm married to my beautiful wife, Margaret, and that's not because of extreme guilt or anything, you know, that led me to find her. It was just because being bisexual, I just happened to find the right person, and that person was a woman. A quick question pertaining to when I was in middle school and high school, and I was just developing my feelings towards men, and at the time, if I would have been outed, I may have taken my life. At the time, because it was so looked down upon in my small little community that was so religious. How would you feel, you know, having the blood of myself and also the blood of millions of others who have taken their lives because of having same-sex attraction? And they aren't alive today partly because of your religion's demands for everyone to think like you. And that's really swayed people to enforce their beliefs on other people.
Yeah, so that's quite an interesting way you've positioned that, Tyler. I don't,
I wouldn't say interested. I'd say disingenuous myself, but I would be very. I would have a significant challenge for the way you phrase that, Tyler. Either we go along with you, or people are going to kill themselves. I don't think that's how you make an argument for something. But I'll let Rylene answer. Yeah.
I have to agree with you. So I think that there is a high degree. I guess I'm going to get into kind of statistics now. There is a higher degree of in the gay community of all kinds of mental illnesses and mental problems. So suicide, suicidal ideation, alcoholism, drug dependence, bulimia, you know, the whole spectrum occurs in a greater degree in the gay community than it does in the general population. So all of those things are there. There is no proof or that much evidence, to tell you the truth, that those things exist in that population because of religious belief systems. And if you look at the statistics, again, you know, all of the various mental health statistics in a country in the United States compared to, for instance, the Netherlands, that has accepted homosexuality for 100 years, really. It's been the most liberal, earliest adopter of anything goes and free thinking and supportive of homosexual lifestyle. Holland, the Netherlands, they're like the earliest and the most. And oddly enough, there's the same suicide rates in comparison to the U.S. There's the same, all of the other mental illnesses pretty much map one. So in this totally accepting environment that's been that way for 100 years and has pretty much wiped out any discrimination or any even judgment about the homosexual lifestyle, compared to the repressive, maybe you might use that word, or judgment-based United States, they're identical. And I think that speaks to the fact that the reason for the suicide is not because you can't say any particular reason for any particular suicide, but I guess I just have to reject the premise that it's based on repressive Catholic thinking.
Tyler, I hope you'll call back sometime. I appreciate it. And next time, just tell the call screener what you want to talk about. You don't have to be deceptive. We would have taken your call anyways. Let's go to Stacy in Omaha, Nebraska, also listening on Spirit Catholic Radio. Glad to have you, Stacy. Go ahead with your question for Rylene Simpson.
Hi. I appreciate you having me on. I'm not a Catholic myself. I am a Christian. And I guess I've always had this question in my head. I'm curious to know, like, when a Catholic or someone is trying to decide whether or not to, say, attend a gay wedding or whatnot, do they have the same reservations when, you know, they get an invite to somebody's second marriage, like they had been divorced before, or maybe a couple that had been living together before they got engaged or even had, you know, children out of wedlock? I'm just wondering if they see it as not a legitimate wedding, or question whether or not they should go like they do for same-sex weddings, because, I mean, they're all sins. So I don't know if there's a hierarchy of sins or whatnot.
Hang on, Stacey.
I love this question. I just love this question, because if they don't, they should. So, yes, sexual sin is sexual sin, right? And I would make a few distinctions in the list that you gave, but we should, as Catholics, there are things that we reject, right? So we reject cohabitation as being sinful. We reject, but if a cohabiting couple is getting married, that's an improvement on their situation, right?
Yeah,
but
that's a different one.
That's a different one, right? Yeah. But gay weddings or second marriages, where the where the first marriage has not been annulled, yes, they should be, a faithful Catholic should be looking at that and saying, if a Catholic is doing that, we should not be attending that wedding, right? Because Catholics, our faith, that we only impose on Catholic people, we don't propose it, but our rules apply to Catholic people. And so if there is a Catholic person who is getting married in a second marriage, and they're inviting their Catholic family and friends, those Catholic family and friends should be gently saying to that couple, we cannot attend this wedding because you're already married to wife number one or husband number one. I love this question, and yeah. It's a reminder for all of those of us who maybe overlook these things on a day-to-day basis. Yeah.
Well, we have an apologist here, Jimmy Akin, who always says the way he makes the decision is if God's coming to the wedding, he's coming. And so if it's two Jewish people getting married, God's coming to the wedding. But if it's two Catholic people who are both previously divorced with no annulment, God's not coming to the wedding. That's not going, and so he's not coming. However, I would say, Stacey, I feel like you're pointing out something that is common among us Catholics, and I think it's actually common among all human beings, which is to say, other people's sins are very serious sins. My sins are not so serious. And is that the undercurrent of what you were getting at, that we might be looking at homosexual people going, yeah, those are serious sins, but when I get a divorce, it's no big deal.
Right. And I guess in the same vein, I always wonder why, you know, I see a lot of, I don't know, protesters against gay rights and whatnot, but then I don't see anybody protesting the rates of divorce in this country, where they're depriving just way more children of a mother-father household than, say, like a gay couple adopting a child out of the foster system. So why is it such a huge deal, you know, when it's two people trying to give a child a two-parent household, but then when it's lots of people that are like men leaving or people getting divorced, and then, you know, I guess I don't, they're also depriving those children of two-parent households. So where's the outrage for that?
It's very inconvenient outrage. But I think you have allies on this program.
I think it's a really valid question, an important question. Yeah. And again, it's a reminder to all of us. But I think also there's not a movement that says, go, yay, divorce, we're pro-divorce, right? Whereas there is a movement that publicly is pushing for gay marriage. See, there's nothing to all these divorces are individual private situations. They shouldn't be happening. They should be working on their marriage. They should be more adult. They should grow up. They should give. You know, there's all kinds of things in a divorce situation. And, you know, unless there's really abuse in the situation, a divorce is not approved. But I think I'm impressed with your knowledge and understanding, Stacey, of the Catholic faith and what is and is not allowed in the Catholic faith.
Yeah.
So I'll say a second thing as well is that you're probably getting us on Catholic radio somewhere. Maybe you're not tuned into a lot of the Catholic magazines and websites and other things where there are we're very much focused on family. Not divorcing, the impact of the sexual revolution on families, the impact of divorce on families. I'm thinking of Jennifer Roback Morse's
Victims of the Sexual Revolution.
Victims of the Sexual Revolution. And I think that if we could, maybe Darren can put it in the show notes or something. We'll look up her website and put it in the show notes, Stacey, because we are talking about this a lot inside of the Catholic Church, but maybe it just isn't.
It's the Ruth Institute, if you guys are looking for it.
The Ruth Institute.
Thank you. Yeah. Stacey, what a great question. Just to be clear, the reason that the cohabiting couple is different is because once they regularize that situation, they can. There is no impediment to them marrying if they'll do what the church asks of them and prepare for marriage properly and be married. So that's actually, we see that one as a really good one. We want to go to that wedding. but the other ones, I like your critique of us, and I think that I appreciate Rylene's answer. Rylene, an hour went by too quickly. Thank you very much.
They always do. Yeah, it's fun.
They do always go by too quickly. But you won't. But you won't do this every month, huh?
Oh well.
I can't get it. I just can't be invited.
To everything I'm invited to.
Oh, well, I will tell Darren that. He's out today, but I'll tell him that. Thanks, everybody, for joining us. That does it for us. We'll see you next time, God willing, right here on Catholic Answers Live.